Hi everyone, it's Vanessa. I'm here to wrap up two things that I read right before Nonfiction November started, as well as a bunch of things that I've read so far this Nonfiction November. The first thing that I wanted to talk about is You Don't Know Everything, Jilly P by Alex Gino. I read Alex Gino's George about a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago at this point, and I really, really enjoyed the way they handled a big subject, a big topic that is important for middle graders to start to be exposed to. In this book, we are also dealing with complex topics again, the deaf community, and also we are dealing with Black Lives Matter issues. So there's just a lot going on here. I value this book for its goals, but I don't really think they were executed as well as George executed its one main issue. This book is only about 200-ish pages. I don't think we got that 3D picture of characters that we really needed to feel an emotional connection for what they were all going through. Some of the audiobook is a little bit too over the top in the delivery of the dialogue or the chat room discussions. I just think that it wasn't as impactful as George was. Though I do love that Alex Gino writes these books to start these conversations, and I think that is very important for middle graders. And then the other book that I finally finished, I read the first probably 80% of it in like 3 days. That was Crazy Rich Asians. And then after that, I kind of just slowed my way down. I just felt like the book was so big. There was so much text, and I didn't think necessarily it needed that many pages. So once I got to page maybe 400, I still had like 100 pages to go. I just stopped reading it and I had to give it back to the library anyway because it was one that I couldn't renew. So I put myself on hold for the audiobook and I waited a while for the audiobook to come in. I finished the book in audiobook format and I think that was a great way for me to finish it on like 1.5 speed. I think this book, I understand why so many people enjoy it. It's a very fast-paced read. It's got some funny, humorous moments that I enjoyed and I laughed out loud with. What this book is lacking and what it really misses is that I don't care for these characters, and I don't really care for the relationship either between Rachel and Nick. I think what the main point of this book is to basically open up this world to you and to let you be a fly on the wall as you're seeing how these people interact, how they spend their money, and kind of like what they stand for, what their morals are when you are so crazy rich. I guess it was fun, but I think I will enjoy the movie more than I enjoyed the book. I thought that the book could have done some things a little bit better. Let's move on to Nonfiction November. The first thing that I finished for Nonfiction November was Chicken with Plums. I actually read this, I think, a day before Nonfiction November started because it was due back at the library and I couldn't keep it any longer. Chicken with Plums by Marjane Satrapi is the story of her uncle, his issues in dealing with depression. He basically stays in his room for 8 or so days and just decides he's going to die. And through the days, you're learning more and more from him and his family as to why he's in this depressive state of mind and his passion for music that is not being fulfilled. So I thought it was good in the same Marjane Satrapi ways where she really goes back and forth and travels through time to fill in the gaps to make you understand why he's in this state of mind. I think because it's not about Marjane Satrapi, I didn't feel as compelled and as in love with it as I have with Persepolis or Embroideries or any of her other works that I have read. It was interesting to see something that wasn't as political. I think I enjoy her political stuff a little bit more, but I would recommend it if you are a Marjane Satrapi fan. The next book that I finished, I listened to on audiobook, and it's The Library Book by Susan Orlean. This one has been getting some buzz from the New York Times Magazine and from the New York Times book review and stuff like that. I was really excited about this one because of the premise. We are following a library fire that we didn't really speak of when it happened in 1986 because it happened in conjunction with the Chernobyl accident and that took up all of the space in the newspapers basically, and we didn't really hear about this. The library burned, a lot of it burned. It was also them trying to figure out who started the fire and going through different leads to see if they could figure out who the suspect is. They did find a suspect, but nothing ever really came of it. They couldn't really find enough evidence to charge him with anything. The book is part that, but it's also part history of the Los Angeles Central Library. It's also part memoir and Susan Orlean's connection with libraries and how she grew up with libraries going with her mother, and it's also part just general journalism of her interacting with library workers and what their day-to-day life is like. And so it just has a lot going on, a lot of different narrative threads that you're following and a lot of different styles that you're following. For me, overall, it worked, mostly I think because I was listening to it on audiobook. I could see where this could get jumbled when you're reading it in the print version of it. I think there's just more an unfocused and meandering narrative drive here of all things libraries, really. It held my attention, but I could see how this could bother some people. The next thing I read is a poetry collection, and that counts as nonfiction, so there you go. I read this for a reading challenge that I'm doing in 2018, and we had to read a poetry collection. I haven't read any poetry this year, guys. So I read Peluda by Melissa Lozada-Oliva. This is a book about our perceptions of body hair, especially her perceptions in her family, in her Hispanic family. I think there are some really powerful poems in here. I really enjoyed, after I read this, I went online and I just YouTubed a bunch of them, and I listened to her perform them out loud. I think that just gives a whole other dimension to poetry, because when I read poetry, I don't have that like fire in me when I'm like reading it as the poets have when they're performing them, and I think that's just a much better way to read it. Let me read really quickly just one part that I enjoyed so you can kind of get a feel of what this is all about. Oh, this one's really good. Mommy says you have been crying. My sister says it's just my makeup. Mommy says you look tan. My sister says I'm just hairy. Mommy says you both should have done this a long time ago. You always let the hair grow so long. Didn't I teach you anything? Shh, basta. There are worse things to cry about. All depression is an American thing. Americans need a name for everything, and I changed mine before they could butcher it. Your eyebrows, they look like trees. And then she discusses how her moving to this country and bringing her family is the real pain. Her children, aka Melissa and her sister, don't understand depression, don't understand pain, don't understand change, and they can't complain about it. And Melissa kind of describing how she has a point, but it's also like, this is the way I feel as well. Remember your body, the body, a land of feelings we've been told to cut down. We rip the things we hate about ourselves out in hope. They grow back weaker, but hair is the only thing that grows the way things grow in the homeland, which is why we get goosebumps when we hear Spanish at the supermarket or when a kiss is planted on the back of the neck. The hair follicles click back to life. The buds shake themselves awake. They rise from the grave we insist on digging. The hair stand up. A million ancestors rooting for the home team. So I really enjoyed this more than I initially anticipated I would enjoy it. All right, the next book I want to talk about is Darkroom by Lila Quintero Weaver. This is a graphic memoir. It is a beautiful graphic memoir. It is all in black and white, and I just really love the style of her drawings. This book is really interesting because it deals with the civil rights movement and segregation in Alabama, but it's made, I think, even more interesting because we're seeing it from Lila Quintero Weaver's eyes, and she is kind of an outsider in the situation. Her and her family moved from Argentina to Alabama when all of this was happening and lived a couple blocks from where people were trying to do drives to register to vote, and where there was violence between police and vigilantes and mobs against black people who were trying to register to vote. I really enjoyed the spreads here. There wasn't a lot of speech bubbles. It was more just kind of recollections and memories that she had, and I love that in graphic memoirs. I think I would rather less dialogue and more just like ideas of what they were thinking at that point. If you at all like graphic memoirs that discuss history, grapple with history, this is a great one, I think, to try out in the same kind of vein of like the March series, but just from just this one little girl who was growing up in this time period and kind of didn't know where she fit in this community. All right, the next book that I finished and I listened to it all on audiobook was Destiny of the Republic by Candice Millard. This one is A Tale of Madness, Medicine, and the Murder of a President. Okay, I did not think I would enjoy this as much as I did. This was recommended to me by someone at work, and I was kind of like, yeah, okay, I'll try it out if you say it's narrative nonfiction. But this really gripped me and made me feel interested in people who were living in the 1800s, which is not something that I really care about in history. In this book, we are focusing on Andrew Garfield and his presidency, including his rise from abject poverty to becoming the president of the United States. It's a really, really fascinating, humanizing history, I think, one where you really care about all of the characters. So this goes back and forth between a few different strands, narrative strands. One of them is following Andrew Garfield coming into the presidency. The other one is following his assassin and his point of view and kind of his descent into madness and why he thought that this was what he needed to do, and this was an act of God, according to him. And also Alexander Graham Bell, who was an inventor, and other doctors who are trying to save Andrew Garfield while he is in agonizing in pain with a bullet in his body. And it's mostly fascinating because you don't really think about what it's like to live in this medical environment where people didn't know about germs, and I think this is like the most interesting aspect of the story, other than Andrew Garfield's personal history, is just how misinformed and how wrong doctors were about how to treat issues like this. Andrew Garfield, if he was alive today and he had the same thing happen to him, he would live past this. The thing that hurt him here is that everybody, doctors, kept putting their fingers inside of his wounds and introducing germs and bacteria and creating infections in his blood. And that is what ultimately killed him. I would definitely recommend this if you're interested in American history. And even if you're not interested as much in older history, I think that the storytelling here and the characters here, the way Candice Millard explains all of that to us, is what makes this book great. Definitely one that I would recommend. Alright, last one. Last night, I finished Stitches by David Small. This is another graphic memoir. I love David Small's art style. I don't think everybody loves it, but I do. I love kind of like this watercolor sort of look and shading that he does and dark lines that he does. I just love it. I just love the way that this looks. This follows David Small growing up in the 40s and 50s. He was born in 1945, and the family that he grew up in and their resistance to talking to each other. They kept everything really deep inside of them, and that made them terribly unhappy people. They were very resentful people. They were really just dysfunctional. They weren't a cohesive family. It also follows David Small's bout with sickness. He got cancer from being exposed to x-rays, another thing that people weren't really aware of back then. Him trying to work through the fact that someone close to him did this to him, basically, and him trying to think through his mother's life, and did his mother really love him as a family? Did they really care about David? Art really becomes a way for him to get out and to grow as a person and to find something that inspires him and that truly makes him happy. This is not a happy book. This is a sad book, and a lot of people won't like that. But I like looking into those dark, grim things about, you know, the inner workings of your mind when it comes to really sad families and dysfunctional families like this. So if you want to look into any of that, I would definitely recommend this. I think it's a great graphic memoir to pick up. That is all the things that I have read. Right now, I currently started Under the Banner of Heaven by John Krakauer on audiobook, so I'm listening to that. I'm still waiting for my audiobook of Palaces for the People to come in. My actual print copy is at the library waiting for me on hold. I think that might be easier to read than this huge ARC. I'm also 80-ish pages into Bonk. All of these things, as you can tell, my problem is that I don't have audiobooks. I really need to just get the CD audiobook of this. There's no e-audio available, which is kind of sad. That is what will get me to read it more quickly. Sometimes I can't really tell what's being serious and what's being funny, and I think the audiobook might help me in that way to understand the author's intention of what's supposed to be funny and what's supposed to be for real. I have gotten a few more things from the library, and I have some things on hold right now that I haven't picked up yet. I just got back from Florida, so I haven't been able to go to the library, and I haven't gone to work since last Thursday. So here's some random things that I picked up in the last week and a half. One thing is Sons of Cain, a history of serial killers from the Stone Age to the present, and this is just a history of serial killers. Another thing that's true crime as well is The Man from the Train, the solving of a century-old serial killer mystery. This is a father-daughter team looking into an old case that I don't think was ever solved. I got this on audiobook as well, and I think that's probably how I'm going to consume it if I end up reading this. I also, because everybody's been talking about it and all of I mentioned it once more, I decided to get The Professor and the Madman, and I'm excited to get to this one. I'm gonna try to see if I can find an audiobook version of it so I can read and listen at the same time. Another book that I'm kind of like iffy about is Heartland, a memoir of working hard and being broke in the richest country on earth by Sarah Smarsh. I started listening to this on audiobook. It's read by the author, and I just didn't like her style and her delivery, so I stopped listening to it. I thought maybe reading it might be better, but we'll see if I really feel compelled to pick this up. A graphic memoir that I saw at the library that I'd never heard of before RX by Rachel Lindsay, and this is supposed to be humorous, a look into her dealing with bipolar disorder while also having a job where she's basically selling pills, dealing with that, like having to have this job to pay for your healthcare to deal with your bipolar disorder, but the things you're selling are kind of contradictory to what you are dealing with mentally. And the art style is pretty loud and big, which I like. So we'll see what I think about this one. And I think that is pretty much it. I have some other things on audiobook and on hold, like I said, and I'll see what I end up listening and reading. I hope that you are having a great nonfiction November. Thanks so much for watching my video. I'll see you in my next one. Bye-bye.